let's just get right into it. My boy is here today. I am excited, Cherie's World Podcast. You are going to get to meet the homie. He is in the flesh live, and you're going to get to see the cute dimples up close and personal.
Oh, man. You know what? I'm supposed to have a mask on so you can't see them.
No.
Yeah, I'm a gangster. I ain't supposed to have them.
We need to see those. We got Mr. Petey Pablo.
No, them bullet wounds. I got shot like 50 Cent.
You was not 50 Cent. So, Petey, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, Cherie, you know, come on, man. We go back like car seats.
How y'all know each other?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. The Lord.
The Lord, okay.
The Lord. No, I was telling Courtney that Barry Hankerson is my brother's godfather.
Right.
And at some point, I could have this totally wrong, but weren't you managed by Black Brown Records or 5150? Or just affiliated?
Well, you know, me and Timberland, that was who Timberland was signed to.
Okay.
And, you know, he used to be around, he used to be around from, I mean, I guess with that whole camp situation.
Yeah.
It's trying to be bigger.
So, Petey, didn't I actually meet you at Will Smith's birthday party or something like that? Or Jada's birthday party?
I think it was Will's birthday party.
At Will's birthday party. Petey walked by with these two big old cute dimples.
And we've been friends ever since, man.
Yeah.
Oh.
Ever since. Like, and it's crazy because we'll see each other for like a good month or two strong, or we'll communicate like a month or two strong, and then we won't talk to each other for years.
Years.
And then we'll pop right back up and it's just like the same day. Yeah. Like the day.
Absolutely. Yeah. The Petey disappearing on you, yo.
Oh yeah, Petey will take off right now. Especially when Petey had that Petey money, that first fresh Petey money. Oh, Petey would jump on a flight and be out.
In a minute. And Petey is so sweet and giving. Actually, Petey and I got in an argument in the mall one day. You remember that, Petey?
No.
Petey, it wasn't bad. You don't have to scratch your head. Oh, Petey was actually trying to be sweet.
What I do?
You were in town and you needed some outfits because you were performing or something. And so
I need outfits anyway. Not just because I was performing, I always need outfits.
But I think you actually had something to do later that night.
Okay.
You start trying to buy me shit.
Yeah, well, I mean, anybody I'm with, I mean, that's how I always am. Like, I'm never been the type to whoever I'm with, wherever we are, you do the same thing I do. And that's a mandatory thing with me. Like, you know, I hate
it. Love him, and I thought it was the sweetest thing in the world. I've never been that woman.
I remember that too. Like we really got in a serious argument. Like,
yes.
I was like, you know what? I'll deal with this later. But yeah, we really did.
We did. And I thought it was the sweetest thing ever, but I love him generally, and I didn't want him to buy me stuff. I didn't want anything. I didn't need anything. I'm not used to men taking me out shopping and doing that. So for me, it was like, I know you just got paid. Keep your money, dude. I love you.
Rare was that, Petey? Like, to see a woman, like, say, nah, I'm good. Like, how unusual is that?
Well, back in the days, for me, it was, well, see, I'm like from another country, it feels like, because, I mean, I take offense to people not accepting gifts from me. Because, I mean, like I said, I've never been married. I never had kids. So, you know, the only thing that I, and back then when I first was signed, my mentality was no one knows tomorrow. I mean, and that's still my mentality. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. So the only thing I like to do is enjoy life. And like I said, if anybody's with me, I want them to enjoy the same perks. So it's not like I'm buying stuff for her. I'm spending the money the way I felt it should be. It would make a difference. Like, instead of going to a strip club and throwing $10,000 in the strip club, you know, for the illusion of what may possibly happen, you know, and versus spending money with the people you are friends with and people you love, you know, so it's like.
And I wasn't trying to offend you. I love you and I appreciate it. And I look back at it now and I'm like, that's so sweet. But my feeling was.
I know.
We don't know when your next job is.
Right. And that's why we've always been friends, because she's always had my back, you know, and she's always, and remember, she's been in the industry longer than I've been in the industry. So what she was trying to tell me, I couldn't understand because I hadn't been there yet. You know, she had already been, you know, doing this from Punk and Brewster days. You know, okay, we get this money, but what happens when this money don't come like that? So she already knew that, and she was forewarning me to let me know that there's going to be some dark days, and you need to make sure you got your umbrella stead, you know. But I've always been the type, hey man, I'm gonna make it happen, and God's gonna make it happen, and any kind of way I have to suffer, He ain't gonna let me suffer too long.
So. But Petey was like, yo, but them shoes is fly. You should just get them shoes.
I'm just telling
I love you for it, though. And I
love you too, man.
And so, Courtney, that's the foundation of our friendship, and that's how real it is.
Yeah.
That's dope.
And that's the only fight we've ever had.
That's it.
That's dope. That's dope. I mean, hey, I like to hear that because, you know, I mean, that means it's like consistent because everybody talks about Cherie the same way.
Everybody talk about it the same way. She's been the same person ever since the day I met her. And that's what keeps my soul at ease when I talk to her, when I talk about her, when I think about her. I mean, it's the knowing that, because sometimes the way we'll deal with people in this world and in this industry, not just in this industry, but in life general, and you'll deal with people, and one day they one way, and they get around certain people, or, you know, something, you know, financially changing people's lives, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, oh, that's my homeboy, oh, that's my homegirl girl going there and say what's up to him, and it's like, hold on, you gotta wait a minute. Like,
yeah.
What?
Yeah, no.
Or hey, look, can you come back tomorrow? Or, hey, the phone number you have reached has been disconnected. I mean, you know, and it's like, come on, man. You know, and that kind of throws me with people. But Cherie has been the same exact way. I mean, the same way with me. I mean, I can't speak for me, but I know I've been the same
way. The same exact way. If Petey was in town right now, and I ran across town because somebody told me Petey Pablo in town, and he's staying at such and such, I'm going to go knock on the hotel door.
Don't give a damn who in there.
No! and ladies, I'm sorry. If you in there with him, just give me a second. How you doing? Nice to meet you, but I'm going to hug on this man real quick and tell him how much I love him and how much I'm happy to see his face. Now we can get back to you. How you doing, ma'am? You want to go to lunch too?
Right, absolutely. Absolutely.
We can all go, but I adore Petey. I have a really soft spot in my heart, and I need to know what you've been doing lately, because I'm kind of mad that I moved away from California.
No, but don't be
in my neighborhood.
Yeah, don't be, because everything, you know, like I tell people all the time, this world is so big, and sometimes we get so comfortable that we almost live and die where we're born and raised, and there's a whole world out there, you know. And you never know the opportunities and, you know, the things that are actually meant for you until you step out. You know, sometimes you have to hit that reset button. You have to go to somewhere where you don't know anybody, don't nobody know you, and you have to do it, you know? And it's like a breath of fresh air. And, I mean, because I've done it several times. I've moved all over. When I moved to California, I went there for an awards. And wind up staying 9 years. Like, all I had was one bag of, well, maybe two, three bags, knowing me, how I shop. But moral to the story is I wind up staying 9 years. And then from California, me and the guy I was doing, had affiliations with, you know, we came to our fork in the road. And I did a show in the Netherlands. And I wind up staying there 3 years. Like, just went there, didn't come back to my house in California, left my house in North Carolina for 3 years until my mom was like, hey, bring your ass home.
And didn't tell nobody. This is how we lose touch.
Nobody. I'll just take off. But what I've been doing lately is I've trying to get back to a place where this felt right. The industry has changed so much, and I didn't know for years what happened and why I didn't want to do music or why I didn't want to be in this entertainment industry. And I finally figured it out one day when I went to visit my mom's gravesite. The reason I was doing this was to give her a better life. Like, I was fine being a drug dealer. I was fine, you know, I was fine running the street, you know, pistol toting, Newport smoking. I was fine with all that. And it was fun. At the time, I knew it was dangerous, but I mean, when you're young and you're living in that street life, that's what you think is cool. And the same cool dude that I am in my real life is the cool dude I've been my whole life. So even as a bad guy, per se, I still had love from everybody. And everyone was still, because, I mean, I wasn't the type to sell drugs to a pregnant woman. Or I wasn't the type to make somebody go break in a house to go do something. I was always doing things that went against the grain of what I was supposed to be doing. Okay, you don't have any money? All right, go get this broom and you clean up this park. Or go get this paintbrush and you paint these monkey bars for these kids here. And you straight. Okay, yes, the little young kids, y'all go and knock on these old people's doors and get these notes that I told these old women. Y'all don't have to be walking up and down the street going to the grocery store when we got young, capable dudes that can go to the grocery store for y'all. Give them a list. And matter of fact, whatever it is, you don't have to pay for it. Because why? First of all, they don't call the police on me. Because, again, I'm like the Robin Hood. I take from whoever and give to the whatever.
But that's his heart. His heart is so golden and it's consistent. I want to know what you was doing in Calabasas. Because not only was you back in California, like, you was really in my neighborhood.
Yeah, man.
And I wasn't like, there.
I'm a traveler. And like I said, I go places that I'm led to go. And when the spirit moves me to go places, this is like, you know, I have to see this. And it's always, when I did my first time away from society, I came up with this plan that I wanted to travel this world, and anything that I thought and anything that I wanted to do and made up in my mind to do, that's what I was going to do. So Calabasas was definitely one of my spots that I had on my wall in prison. It was like my wish wall. So everything that I've ever wanted, I was like, you know what? If I change all the negative things and do it all positive, whether I make $5 or whether I make $5 million, I've done it the right way and I can go to bed and be comfortable at night. So I said, let me give it a shot. I mean, I did a bad thing for a long time and I was very successful with it. And so I was like, let me try it the right way. And trying it the right way was more fulfilling spiritually and emotionally, I mean, than I've ever felt in my life. So that change that I caused in my life, man, had me all over the place.
So